Okay, welcome to yet another virtual event with Neighbors on Call. I'm Susan Blunt, one of the directors, and Becca Zirkin, our other director, is on here too. Thanks for coming, and thank you to our guests tonight. We're very pleased to have Nicole Quick, candidate for North Carolina House District 59 in Guilford County, and to State Representative Graig Meyer. Thanks so much for taking time to be with us tonight. We're really excited to be in the Zoom with you. Quickly, before we get into the program, let's just review how to do Zoom. Hard to imagine anybody doesn't know by now, but just real quickly, the basics. Note the Zoom control buttons are across the bottom of your screen. And the first thing I want everybody to do is to stop your video. That's the second little icon on the bottom row. It's really helpful because it reduces the network traffic and improves the video quality for our program. Then next in the middle, you'll see a little button for chat. After Nicole and Representative Meyer speak, you can click on that to enter your questions there. And last, in the top right corner, there's a little toggle switch for speaker view versus gallery view. Gallery view is fun when we're all chit-chatting, but I recommend when it's once our program starts, which I guess is now, that you click on speaker view. So everybody turn off your volume now, okay? If you're just learning about Neighbors on Call, thanks so much for coming in particular and welcome. Neighbors on Call, or affectionately we call it NOC, is an all-volunteer grassroots group. Our goal is to flip at least one chamber of the North Carolina General Assembly this year, which means helping to flip 6 House seats or 5 Senate seats, or preferably both. There are activists all across the state focused on the same mission, and NOC has a very important role to play in it all. It's especially important now because next year, 2021, our General Assembly will redraw our voting district maps for the state Senate, the state House, and the U.S. Congress. Having fair maps is key for getting our democracy back on track. To do this, it's going to require reaching out to other voters like us. In 2018, we helped break the supermajority in the General Assembly by knocking on over 15,000 doors. For the 2020 elections, because of COVID-19, instead, we are phone banking, which is the next best thing to knocking on doors. We're working with 4 North Carolina House campaigns. 2 we need to flip, which would include Nicole Quick's district in Guilford and Ricky Hurtado's in Alamance. And then there are 2 in Wake that we need to hold for Representative Sidney Batch and Representative Terrence Everett. Campaigning for these state legislative races will help us turn North Carolina blue all the way to the top of the ticket. So far, our fabulous team, that's you, has completed more than 720 phone bank shifts, 720 phone bank shifts since late March. So way to go, team.
That is awesome. So now we are welcoming our 2 guests tonight. Knowing them has helped us imagine how Democratic leadership in the NCGA could transform our state, and that gets us fired up to help Nicole win this race. First, Representative Meyer is going to give us an update from the General Assembly, and then he's going to help us learn more about Nicole. And finally, they will both take your questions. Nicole Quick is an outspoken advocate for our public schools. At Guilford Mills and Brayton International, she held business management responsibilities. And when her son, Tad, was diagnosed with autism, she decided to leave her business career behind to provide daily occupational therapy for him. She was a one-on-one aide in the classroom with him, and later she led teacher instruction about working with children with autism. Her district was redrawn more favorably last year, and we can help flip it. Representative Graig Meyer has served in the North Carolina House of Representatives since 2013. He represents House District 50 in Orange and Caswell counties. He is one of only 3 trained social workers in the legislature, as is our friend, Representative Sidney Batch. Representative Meyer worked in public schools for 16 years, and now he continues to work on equity issues with schools and nonprofits as a consultant. He's the co-chair of the House Democratic Caucus Campaign Committee, which means he's overseeing the 2020 election operations. He's been named Legislator of the Year by both Equality NC and the North Carolina Young Dems, and a Green Tie Rising Star by the League of Conservation Voters. Also, he used to be a DJ. Welcome to you both. Representative Meyer, we hand it off to you.
Thank you, Becca. Thank you, Susan. Thank you, Neighbors on Call. Y'all are just so amazing. I just came off another Zoom tonight with a statewide organization that had fewer people on the Zoom than y'all have just from organizing folks in our backyard. You're doing such an amazing job. And we're so appreciative of what you're doing to focus on North Carolina's legislature. And you know, Becca said, you know, what if we could imagine what it would mean to have different leadership in North Carolina's legislature? And you're here because you already understand that, well, the vast majority of political watchers are focused on our presidential race and maybe the U.S. Senate race, and so consumed by what's happening in the White House and in Congress that there are so many issues in our own backyards that are impacted more by the legislature than they are by our Congress. I've had so many people who talk to me about reopening the schools, about UNC students coming back. And when it comes to education, whether it be K-12, higher education, or early childhood, that is all in the domain of states. The federal government plays a very limited role in deciding what happens with schools, and particularly in the midst of the COVID pandemic, what's happening in schools and how we're responding is almost all dealt with at the state legislature level, legislative level. Speaking of COVID and the pandemic, imagine what kind of response we'd have if we had Democrats in charge of the legislature right now, and we were drawing up the plans for how to spend the budget to respond to COVID. Right now, when the federal unemployment benefits have just unexpired for hundreds of thousands of North Carolinians, and where North Carolina's unemployment system is one of the worst in the country, and we only offer people 12 weeks of benefits, where nationwide the average is 26 weeks, we are about to have hundreds of thousands of people who are going to go without any income at all because of North Carolina's poor benefits and the federal inaction. Democrats in the legislature tried to extend the benefit period for unemployed folks during COVID. We have tried to increase the amount of benefits that people have would be eligible for. Republicans blocked any attempts that we made to improve unemployment benefits. What they did instead is they passed multiple bills trying to reopen businesses that we know would be public health risks. Thankfully, Governor Cooper vetoed all of those bills, and Democrats sustained the veto. Governor Cooper's veto, since we broke the supermajority in the 2018 election, Governor Cooper has vetoed 25 bills, and Democrats have been able to sustain every single one of those vetoes. And when the Republicans were trying to force us to reopen businesses and put our public health at risk, Democrats suggested other types of common sense plans. We said, look, we think that these businesses need to stay closed for the benefit of everyone, but we don't think that the businesses should be punished for being singled out by executive orders. So Representative Sidney Batch, my good friend and Knox's good friend, introduced an amendment to one of the reopening bills to take $50 million of unappropriated CARES money. This is money sitting on the table. And she said, let's take this $50 million and let's give it as grants to small businesses that are in the categories that you're trying to reopen. Republicans used a procedural motion to block even having a vote on that amendment. They didn't even let us have an up or down vote. Then guess what they did? Those cynical fools, the very next day, they brought back Representative Batch's exact amendment. They put it in the hands of Representative Ross, who Ricky Hurtado is running against. And I know that you all are very active in supporting Ricky. They tried to give him a campaign issue. They took Representative Batch amendment exact with one change. They increased the amount that it would spend from $50 million to $100 million and passed that amendment on their own terms rather than letting Representative Batch run that amendment when she had been the original one to put it forward. Now, what happened? Did we actually spend $100 million on supporting these small businesses that have been hurt by COVID? The suspense is killing you. Of course we didn't. Because the Republicans passed it in the House to give Representative Ross something to campaign on against Ricky Hurtado. But when it went over to the Senate killed that provision because the Republicans have no interest in actually doing something like that to actually help small businesses. All they want to do is whatever they think can be ideological. And right now their ideology is don't wear masks and reopen all the businesses. It's just ridiculous. So here's where we are in this year's campaigns and how we can change all of that in Raleigh. We know that North Carolina is going to be one of the top battleground states in the country. There will be millions, tens of millions, hundreds of millions, possibly $1 billion spent on elections here. If you combine up what Republicans and Democrats spend and you combine what's spent by campaigns and what's spent by dark money organizations, $1 billion for elections is insane. But we're so glad that you're focused on legislative elections, because two thirds of that or more, maybe three quarters, maybe more than that, will be spent on just three campaigns. It'll be spent on the presidential election, the gubernatorial election, and the Senate election. Our budget to flip the North Carolina House, we hope to get to $10 million total. It's a fraction of what's gonna be spent by those other huge races. To win a seat like House District 59 where Nicole is running, we would be happy to spend $400,000. That would be amazing. And so we have the ability to make an impact on flipping legislative seats for so much less money than what gets spent on those bigger picture races. Now, of course, we can't do that with only money. We have to do it with help from people like you reaching out and talking directly to voters, particularly when someone like Nicole isn't able to knock on doors, because we've got to talk to those voters on the telephone or by text banking. And honestly, we need telephone callers more than text bankers. It's actually pretty easy and cheap to pay text bankers. It's not the same for phone bankers, and phone bankers are better when they're more authentic, when it's you actually talking to someone. And that's why Knox's work is so important to a race like Nicole's. Now, here's what we're seeing on the ground. We're in the middle of polling all of our competitive districts right now. And I can't give you details on individual districts, but here's what I can tell you in general. There are districts right now that we feel like we have a great chance to win, but there are a bunch of districts that are going to be dogfights, even though we see that Governor Cooper is thankfully far up in the polls. He's clearly demonstrated his leadership. Even though we have seen that the Biden campaign is running well in North Carolina and looks like we have a chance to send Democratic nominators to the Electoral College to support Joe Biden for president. That would be amazing. And Cal Cunningham looks like he's got a shot to win. We see that our Democratic candidates are running really, really well in counties like Wake County, Orange County, Durham County, Chatham County. They will run up the score in those counties. They would love to get 70 to 80% of the vote in Orange County or Chatham County. But in Nicole's district, now they might like to get 60% of the vote in Guilford County, but if you look just at Nicole's district, Governor Cooper, Vice President Biden, Cal Cunningham, they don't even have to get 51% in Nicole's district. They would be happy taking 45, 46, 47% of the vote in Nicole's district, because they're gonna rack up the score in the rest of Guilford County or in counties like ours. But you know what? Nicole Quick can't win with only 47% of the vote. She has to get 51% of the vote. So we have to run strong legislative campaigns. We can't depend on what's happening from those big campaigns. And what we're seeing in districts like Nicole's is that there are tons of Republicans who are giving up on Donald Trump. His approval rating is not good. There are people who are not sure about voting for him. There are even fewer people who want to vote for Dan Forrest. He's even less popular than President Trump. But those people who might be giving up on Trump or Forrest are not necessarily giving up on Republicans all the way down the ticket. So we can't take that for granted, that it means that Nicole will be able to win. And if she can't flip voters who would likely vote Republican to vote for her, then you know what we have to do? We have to talk to voters who would most likely vote for Democrats, would vote for Nicole, but aren't guaranteed to show up at the polls. And if we can talk to those voters who we know would vote for us if they would just come out, and convince them to come out, then that's a vote for Nicole Quick. And you might like to think that, why would they stay home, given everything that's happened with President Trump, everything that's going on in North Carolina, how great Governor Cooper is doing, all those things. How in the world could someone stay home? But you know that a good large portion of the electorate is turned off to politics altogether, has many, many reasons why they don't come out to vote. There are, in every legislative district, there are probably tens of thousands of votes that could be collected if we just got those people to come out. And we have to put a priority on getting those folks out for Nicole and for our other competitive candidates. That's why we need volunteers like you who are talking directly to those voters. I heard Becca complain she won't be able to wear her purple sweatshirt this year, but Becca, put on that purple sweatshirt and use it while you're on the phone. You don't have to drive to Nicole's district this year. The 2 hours that you would spend each way driving to put in a knocking shift, you can now use those extra 2 hours on the phone talking to voters directly. Because you don't have to be there in person, you can talk to even more voters than you have before. So we are so appreciative to have your help. I'm looking forward to seeing everybody that you can work with, all of our candidates. I'm glad you're doing these sessions to get to know them. Can't wait for you to get to know Nicole a little bit better tonight. I want to turn it over to Nicole, and I am anxious to hear what she has to say, because the last time we were on a Zoom together, we had a great post conversation where we debriefed her stump speech and we talked about how it could get better. And I want to see where it is today, because I haven't heard her give it since then. So I'm really excited for you to meet Nicole Quick, our candidate for House District 59. She's running against John Hardister, who is, this is being recorded, I got to be careful what I say. Let's say this. He is the whip of the Republican caucus. So he is a rising star, someone they think has the capacity to run for a national, congressional or statewide office in the future. But he is one of the weak, you know how we look at all the Republicans now, like, I don't know if you saw the Lincoln Project ad today about Susan Collins, of all these people that think they're supposed to be the independent Republicans will stand up and work across the aisle, blah, 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 but they just toe the party line. Yeah, that's John Hardister. Like, I used to get along great with that guy. We used to think we could work together on things. We passed a bill together. It was one of the least meaningful bills that's ever passed. You can ask me about that in questions if you want. But I can't work with him anymore, because now he just toes the Republican Party line. He's not someone who will work across the aisle. He is someone who just does what his leadership tells him. And you know what? We don't need his leadership to be in leadership anymore. We need Democratic leadership. And that's why we need Nicole Quick elected, so we can have a Democratic majority. Ladies and gentlemen, and here is Nicole Quick, candidate for House District 59.
Thank you, Greg. It's great listening to Greg talk, because he is so motivational that I want to go phone bank for myself right now. That's how motivational he is. So I appreciate you being here and your support. And I appreciate everyone with Neighbors on Call. A lot of you have been phone banking for me. It's making a difference. As Greg mentioned, there are polls in the field right now, so we'll have more numbers soon to give you a better idea of how we're doing. But the perception is that we are neck and neck in a dead heat with John Hardister right now. So many of you know me, you've heard my story. The question I always get is, why are you running? And I'm guessing most candidates get that question at some point, because it's important to know why a candidate gets into politics, into a race. So the short answer that I always give is my son, Tad. Tad is, he's brilliant, he's highly gifted, but he is also on the autism spectrum. So when we got ready to send him off to our neighborhood school here for third grade, it was in 2013, this Republican legislature had just made these huge cuts to the education budget for Guilford County. That meant that 37 teachers had been laid off here. And one of those teachers happened to be the EC teacher at our neighborhood school. So Tad wasn't gonna have any support there. His occupational therapist called me up. She said, you know what? He's gonna struggle. He's not gonna thrive there. So I was fortunate enough, I made the decision I was gonna keep him home. I homeschooled him for 2 years. And at that point, he was ready to move on to our elementary middle school down the road, Lincoln Academy. And they had great support, wonderful EC teacher, wonderful guidance counselor. All of their staff and teachers were just great with Tad. What they didn't have was air conditioning for 2 years on the second floor of the building. So the teachers would have to take the classes outside on hot days. Now, you know what it's like in North Carolina in May, June, even September into early October, usually. It gets hot. So they would have to go outside and try to teach outside because it was just too hot on the second floor of the schools. They would also have to have a substitute for math because at the beginning of Tad's sixth grade year, the math teacher left, went to Virginia where she could earn a decent wage, get paid, and they couldn't find a replacement for her. So they didn't have a math teacher for a whole semester. Now, Tad's okay, he's 16. He turned out fine, but what I discovered in the process of advocating for him was that these stories weren't unique to us. They were happening all across the state. Lots of families were experiencing the same struggles and frustrations. And that frustrated me. When I was growing up in North Carolina, we had an education governor. We had Jim Hunt. We were known nationally for our public schools, for our Smart Start program, and we can do that again. You know, I have a background in economics, and what I learned when I was studying economic development is that the only path to long-term sustained economic development is to invest in your workforce. You have to have a healthy and educated workforce. So our children are our future. If we don't invest in our schools for a moral imperative, because we should give our children the best, then we should invest in them because that is the economic future of this state. So that is why I'm running. That's why I got into this race. As you've heard, this race is competitive because the district was redrawn. It went from laying 12 points Republican to a 2-3 point race after it was redrawn. And I want to go rally and fight. I want to fight for your children and for all the children across the state who deserve better. So thank you.
So thank you, Nicole. And we're going to have a little chat now for a little bit. And I want to start out with, we're going to trade questions. I want to start out with questions for you. Let's talk about your district. So I think folks know a lot of, you know, maybe they know a little bit about Guilford County, but probably more about Greensboro than they know about your part of the county. What should they know about your district? It's not a lot of Greensboro. There's a lot more to Guilford County. What do you think people should know about where you're running?
So my district is on the eastern side of Guilford County. It runs from Greensboro over to the Alamance County line. It is mostly rural to suburban. And when I moved here, we built our house 20 years ago. There were 8 houses on my street and a pasture of cows at the end of the road. So 15 years ago, they put in the I-85 bypass. And after that, all of these developments just sprung up out here and hundreds of houses. So now what you've got is you've got a lot of younger, progressive people, more diversity along the highway and off the highway. But as you go north and south from there, you still have very rural communities. You have a lot of cute little small towns like Gibsonville and Whitsitt and Pleasant Garden, and you very much get a small town feel from them. But then you're still close enough that you can go into Greensboro and experience all the things that a decent sized city has to offer.
Got it. And when you're talking to voters and you have that broad range of voters, are you able to find a message where you can really communicate to all of them at once? Do you have to differentiate your message? What have you learned about how to communicate with everybody in your district?
So I am really trying to talk to working people and families. When I'm talking to folks, I don't necessarily think of whether they're Republican or Democrat. My district's divided up into thirds almost, with Republicans, Democrats, and unaffiliated voters. But I want to go to Raleigh to help working people and families. And what I found is that everybody here cares about the cost of healthcare. Everybody cares about the quality of the schools their children are attending. They all care about whether or not they're going to be able to get a good job that pays them a decent wage so they can take care of their families and live a decent life. So those are kind of the things that I am focusing on when I talk with them, those issues that cross party lines and matter to all of us.
So when you hear those voices and you hear those things and you think about getting to Raleigh, what are you going to do? What are going to be the bills you're going to introduce?
So obviously first thing on the agenda is to expand Medicaid. That was on the agenda before COVID, but COVID has shown just how bad our system is. It exacerbated that lack of healthcare coverage. I think the last numbers I heard, we went from 500,000 people falling in that coverage gap to over 700,000 now. So that's gotta happen. People shouldn't have to choose whether they can pay for their health care or food or rent. So that would be first. You know, before this pandemic, I would have said my next priority would be to pass Governor Cooper's budget for education and start addressing that. And that is still a priority. Right now, though, I'm really worried about one of the issues you mentioned earlier, Greg. I'm worried about the moratorium on evictions expiring. I'm worried about people not getting more unemployment benefits and not being able to pay the rent and being out on the streets and the downward spiral that that can cause. A lot of people would struggle to recover from that. It's much harder to get a job if you don't have an address. It's much harder to attend school, much less virtual school, if you're a child whose family's living on the street. So I think that we're gonna have to think about how we're gonna help people recover from this pandemic. And that's gonna be a big, big issue.
Yeah, for sure. You know, we had a bill in the House that was actually led by a Republican that would have helped with the eviction assistance. And it was a good example of where sometimes you have to take strange bedfellows, that they were interested in putting money into preventing evictions because they wanted to help landlords. As the guy who introduced the bill is a mortgage banker. And so he's interested in his clients making sure that they can pay their mortgages. But I told them, I was like, that's a great bill. We'd be happy to support that because it's a win-win for both landlords and tenants. But even with the Republican sponsoring that bill, it still didn't go anywhere because the response to COVID has been so completely inadequate at the legislative level. It's really embarrassing and disappointing and saddening for the people of North Carolina. Nicole, give us something personal so that we can help our audience tonight get to know you a little bit outside of the political arena. What's a non-political accomplishment that you're proud of?
I have to say,
you can brag on yourself.
I am proud of the job my son and I did when we homeschooled, because I never thought I would be capable of that. I tend to be kind of a type A personality, a little impatient at times. And we had to put together a complete curriculum because he was all over the place. He was in third grade and he was reading on 10th grade level. His math skills were on a sixth grade level, but then his handwriting was on preschool level. So, you know, and I had to build, because he is on the spectrum, I had to build social skills curriculum into it. So we started from scratch, put everything together, customized for him, so that when he did finally go back into the public school system, he was able to be successful. So I'm really proud of both of us for being able to accomplish that together.
Great. So if you are on the Zoom and you are someone who has been homeschooling for the last couple months because of Nicole, because of COVID, or if you have a similar experience of working with a child with a developmental disability like Nicole, will you show her a little love in the chat and just say, like, we understand you. Thank you so much. And it's great. Love that example. So I have one more question for you, Nicole, which is, do you have anything that's happened so far on the campaign trail that has been funny or heartwarming, endearing, anything, any good campaign trail story you can tell us?
I do have a funny story. So when we were out canvassing in Whitsitt, my son did go with me. And as I mentioned earlier, he likes to canvas. So we come up to this door and we knock on the door, and this guy comes and he opens the door and I introduce myself. I tell him who I am, what I'm running for. And, you know, he says to me, he's like, well, you know, I'm unaffiliated. I'm an independent. I don't like Republicans or Democrats. You're all, you know, just destroying our country. And my son, who is very direct, steps up and he says, you know what? I agree with you. And I'm standing there, and at this point my mouth is kind of probably dropped and I'm speechless. And he says, you're right. They're both crap. He says, but you know what? He said, at least the Democrats are not racist, corrupt crap. And so this guy, you know, he looks at him, he's like, yeah, well, you're not wrong. And he's like, so my son says, so, you know, you should vote for the lesser of two evils. And I'm still standing there with my mouth open, right? And, you know, the guy's like, I will definitely consider that. You've made a good point. He takes the literature. And, you know, Tad looks at him before we walk away. And he says, besides, you know, my mom, I tell her all the time, she is... she's too moderate, but she has a good heart. So I think she's trying to do the right thing. So, you know, that was probably my most interesting canvas encounter ever. So that was a lot of fun. It turned out all right. The guy, I think, was convinced at that point.
Love it. I think if I was Ted, I would say, like, yeah, sure, but as my mom just showed up on your door, have any Republicans showed up on your door? Like, I think there's a difference there. All right, hey, let's pull back the curtain for a second, Nicole, and let's turn the tables. And you're about to head into the heat of campaign season. Like, this is actually the last little bit of sanity before everything turns nuts. When your poll comes back and you start drafting mail pieces and all of that, the rest of your campaign cycle, the next 97 days, however many days it is, it's going to be insane. So what are you stressed about? What are the problems that you're facing? What are you worried about? What do you want to ask me? We'll pull back the curtain. You get to ask me the question on campaigning and what should you be doing. We'll let people see what's really behind the scenes, what's going through your mind right now, what's making your heart beat, what's keeping you up at night.
So what do I need to expect? I mean, I know this election year is not like previous election years in a lot of ways, but there have to be some things that are going to come up that I'm just not going to, like you said, be prepared for. So what is the craziest or worst thing that I can expect as we move forward?
Well, they're going to lie about you. I mean, that's predictable, right? There's going to be mail pieces or television commercials that really just don't feel like they're accurate to you. And you will just think, how in the world could they say this about me? My example of that is actually kind of amusing because I think the Republicans really backfired. But in my first campaign, they sent a mail piece about me. And what bothered me about it was they had a photo that I had taken of myself and my sons at a Moral Mondays march. And they used that photo, they took it off my social media, and they used it to basically say I was a bad father for taking my sons to Moral Mondays. And I was like, well, that's laughable. But I also was really angry that they brought my kids into the campaign, which was something that I had intentionally not done. And so I felt that was a real intrusion. But on the flip side, which was the front of the piece that they mailed, it said, Graig Meyer is bringing the ideas of Barack Obama to Orange County. And it had a picture that was half my face and half Obama's face. And I was like, oh my God, this is great. Like, I hope you mailed this to 80,000 Orange County voters, because that's really, really exactly what I'm doing. I'm bringing the ideas and policies of Barack Obama to Orange County. I have no idea why they thought that would be effective mail hit piece on me. But you are likely to face so many more negative pieces. You will probably see 20 to 25 mail pieces attacking you. You will see television commercials that are just nasty. And it's going to be hard to just sit through it. And You're going to wonder the next time you make a phone call, has somebody seen that commercial and what do they believe about you? And it's going to be hard.
Well, let me ask you this. In the course of running, or since you've been in public life, have you gotten direct messages on your social media asking for pictures of your feet?
No, that sounds especially sexist. I haven't gotten that. Okay. So let's put that up in the high range of bizarre things, and I'm sorry that happened to you.
All right, so that's specifically maybe for female candidates then, I guess. So what is, since you've been elected, what is maybe your worst day in the legislature?
The day that House Bill 2 passed was my worst day in the legislature. The Republicans called a special session. We didn't know exactly what they were going to do. When we showed up, they introduced the bill. We gaveled into session, and they immediately gaveled us out and to send us to committee. And they introduced the bill in committee, and it was clear that all of the Republicans had already seen the bill, and they were all signed up, and we had never seen it before. We knew that it was going to be something in response to Charlotte's attempt to introduce some equality measures, but we didn't know what it was going to be specifically. There were lots of advocates there, and during the public hearing, during the committee meeting, our committee meetings don't work the same as public hearings do in like a town council or school board meeting. And in general, if there's a contentious issue, they allow people to speak, but they alternate one from each side, one for and one against the bill. And so we had to sit there in the public hearing and hear impassioned pleas from queer friends, and especially trans friends, about don't do this to us. And then alternating with voices of people that were just outwardly hateful and bigoted. And so just sitting through that, listening to both sets of voices was especially anguishing. And then when we got back to, you know, the bill passed committee, went back to the House and had to take the vote on it, we knew we were gonna lose. And sitting there and knowing that I was going to lose and that people that I know and love and care about were going to be directly harmed by the state that they call home, that was the most difficult day for me. That particular bill I used to say this more often, but I just remind people, after the passage of the Civil Rights Act in 1964, in the entire United States, every piece of civil rights legislation that had passed at either the federal or state level since 1964, had almost every piece of legislation had been positive, moving us forward towards more civil rights until North Carolina passed House Bill 2. It was the largest step back on civil rights since the Civil Rights Act, and just horrible for the people of North Carolina. And let's not forget who did that. And we know that, you know, we're in an age where that bill is moot now, but we still would like to repeal it from the books and put in place further equality provisions for folks here in North Carolina.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So that is incredibly sad and horrible that they did that. So let me change the mood a bit. So when you were elected, what was the first bill you sponsored? Do you remember?
I don't remember what the first bill I sponsored was or co-sponsored. That's interesting. If you go back and look it up, it's actually pretty easy to figure out on the legislative website. I do remember that the first bill that I really cared about writing my freshman year, I came from the school system, and I've always worked on racial equity in schools. And I worked with the Council of State Governments to draft a bill that would create a better system for tracking data on student discipline in North Carolina. This has been obviously a big issue over the last few months as we thought about how policing in schools intersect. But going back to 2014 or 2015, this was something that I was really passionate about. And I actually lined up a couple of Republicans who worked with me to co-sponsor this bill. And so I was really hopeful that we could, all it was gonna do is just make sure we collected better data on student suspensions and expulsions and really try to figure out how does the school to prison pipeline work and where do we have school districts that are suspending and expelling too many kids and which districts are doing better. It was all just data. And I still am really passionate about that bill. You were asking for a happier story, but this one's gonna end in frustration too, because we are talking about the North Carolina General Assembly. Like, I can't give you a lot of hopeful anecdotes. I got one of the chairs of the education committee to agree to hear the bill. He liked the bill. And the day before it was gonna get heard in committee, he called me and he said, your bill's being blocked by one of the other chairs. So the way the Republicans do this is that they have multiple chairs on every committee. And they alternate turns of who's chairing the committee meeting, and whoever's chairing gets to decide what bills are gonna be put on. But one of the other chairs, if you're not the chair for that meeting, you can block a bill from getting put on. So the first chair called me and said, the second chair is blocking your bill from being put on. And so I went to that second chair and I said, like, hey, like, what's the issue? And he went on this whole line of excuses of why he didn't want to do this bill because he thought it was going to be bad for school systems. And I kind of debunked each of his excuses. And then he said to me, he said, you know, Representative Meyer, these school districts that you're trying to target with this bill. And as soon as he said that, I was like, oh, here we go. Now I finally get this. These school districts, like these people, like he was thinking that it was specifically targeting school districts with a high percentage of Black students, which wasn't true at all. It could be targeting Chapel Hill Carborough schools or Guilford County schools equally, or any school district in the state, because we have the school to prison pipeline problem everywhere. But he went down this path about these school districts. And he said, he had just told me a minute before he didn't want the school districts to have more lawsuits brought against them. And I said, this is actually going to decrease the number of lawsuits because there's a lot of lawsuits around this that are brought through the Office of Civil Rights. And then he says, these school districts, what they really need is they need some tough love. I was like, so you're talking about these people, they need tough love. Like, this is this whole Republican thing about that's what Black and brown people need. They need tough love. And I went home that night and I turned on the TV, and it was the third night of the protests in Baltimore after the Freddie Gray murder. And I said, you know, I get it. This guy is not going to let a bill helping Black and brown people who are unfairly impacted by schools, police, and prisons. He is not going to help them while these protests are on TV. He is not going to do anything for those folks. And if he's not going to do that and they're not going to do that, then I need to be in charge. And that was one of the days where I realized that I wasn't going to be able to make a difference by trying to work with the Republicans, that I needed to go out and figure out how to beat the Republicans, become that committee chair myself, so that we can run those bills and take care of the people in North Carolina.
Agreed. Let's do that.
So,
how are we on time? We still
should
we got
turn it over? Should we open it up for a Q&A from the audience? We can do that.
Yeah.
Hang on, folks. What we'd like to do, I know it, Becca and I, we would like to, first of all, thank you so much. And I think we could enjoy this conversation for another hour, but I don't know that we'd keep our audience that long. So anyway, folks have lots of questions, but first we want to show you the upcoming opportunities for you to contact voters, just like Greg and Nicole have been talking about, and her district and the others that we're supporting too. Any minute now, a slide will pop up with the list. There we go. We encourage you to sign up for two in August. There you go. You can see the list of canvases there. Now, Becca.
We know some people feel uncomfortable about phone banking. We totally get that. But we do provide support to help you out. And even though you're doing this alone from home, you'll be online with the campaign crew and the other Neighbors on Call callers. So you're not gonna feel alone. Here's how that works. We send you a script and information about the candidate in advance. The phone bank starts with a training Zoom, and often the candidate, Nicole, will be there to talk to us. Then we make our calls, and while that's going on in parallel during the phone bank, you can chat online with the other callers. And we will not be trying to persuade any voters. Just like Greg said, this is about turnout. We are turning out other like-minded folks. And then at the end, everyone meets up again to debrief at a Zoom at the closing. Back in June, we held a training session on phone banking called Overcoming Phone Bank Fear and Loathing. And if you missed it, we invite you to watch the recording of it to help you get started. I promise that it will help. And it's on our website under resources. We also hope you'll join us again on Monday, August 10, when State Representative Zach Hawkins of Durham and Seth Morris, the North Carolina Democratic Party Senior Counsel and Voter Protection Director, will join us to talk about protecting the vote, because we know everyone has a lot of questions about this election, in particular voting by mail. And so we hope you'll come for that. And then on Wednesday, August 19th, Tom Jensen, who's the Director of Public Policy Polling, is going to join us to give us a peek into what the latest polls are saying about the North Carolina legislative races. So now you know you need to sign up, you know what the options are, you know we'll be there to support you. And now we turn it over to Patience and Bonnie, who are going to tell us what's going on in the chat and pass on some of your questions.
Okay, I'll start out with a comment that Robin made. Robin's been doing a lot of phone banking for you, Nicole, and she said that your commitment to public education has really resonated with voters that she's talked to while she's been phone banking. There have been several questions related to public education. One is kind of a general question, which you can narrow down if you want to, but Dina wants to know, what's the legislative path back to better public education in North Carolina? How can we get back to where we need to be?
So I think that, we've got to start by addressing the Leandro lawsuit and the suggestions that were laid out in that. We've definitely got to raise teacher pay so that we are attracting and retaining teachers, get that back at least above the national average, get our per pupil funding back up. And something that Graig touched on earlier, equity across education. We've got to be able to help those students who start out at risk and give them support to get a better start so that when they join their peers in school that they are better prepared to be successful. Graig, okay. You got things to add to that?
I'll just add that two of the bills we introduced this year, I was primary sponsor of one of them, were responses to the Leandro case. If you don't know about the Leandro case, the courts here in North Carolina have found that we are in breach of our constitutional obligation to provide all students with a sound basic education. And that means that especially in low performing and low wealth school districts, we are not ensuring that kids have what they need. And so there's been a consent order that the parties have put in recommendations of saying essentially over the next 8 years, we need to increase funding and support for schools to do a whole list of things. And what we did is we introduced two bills, Democrats introduced two bills in the House, one that laid out all the policy changes that we would make, and a second that laid out all of the new spending that we would make in the first year of those 8 years. And it included things like rebuilding our teacher pipeline and setting new goals for teacher diversity that we've never had before. It included expanding early childhood education. It included increasing the support that we have for low performing schools to make sure that they have additional resources. It included raising the cap on the number of students who can be funded in any school district for special education services. Most people don't know this, but North Carolina has a cap that any given school district can only receive funding for up to 12.5% of its students who are labeled as special education. So if you have 13% of your kids who have an IEP, you only get paid for 12.5% of those kids rather than 13% of those kids. And we think that's crazy. If you have a learning disability, you should get funded to take care of your learning disability no matter what it is. So that was one of the things that we would change immediately.
Okay. Graig, Ed asked this question earlier and Tracy has asked the same question again. Are you supportive of reaching out and encouraging voters to vote by absentee ballot by mail? And Tracy's wondering if you have any concerns that Republicans will try to invalidate mail-in voting.
So I have a lot of concerns about mail-in voting, and I have a very specific recommendation for how we should approach voting this year. And I think that you will see that the scripts that we are using start to reflect what I'm about to lay out to you. Right now, we've done research at how mail-in voting has worked in other states that have shifted to it. And we've looked at mail-in voting patterns in North Carolina of folks who request an absentee mail-in ballot. And it looks like on average, about 4% of folks who request a mail-in ballot and attempt to return it or fail to return it, about 4% of the folks who request mail-in ballots don't have their ballots counted. And this is not for any nefarious reasons. This is because they either don't turn it in, or they don't turn it in on time, or they don't complete it the right way. And we cannot afford to lose 4% of our voters this year. So what I recommend is that if people say that they want to vote by mail, that we should be prepared to help them learn how to do that. And if they say that, we should also be committed to following through with them to make sure that they actually do vote by mail, because they can't wait till the last minute. There's a hybrid solution. Some people can request it, and you can, anybody can do this. You can request a ballot by mail and get it mailed to your house and then hand deliver it to your board of elections or to a polling place so that it gets counted that way. But if you want to vote by mail, absolutely vote by mail. Send it in. Don't show up at the polling place. But I don't know that we want to encourage everyone to go to that because of the loss that we see. And one other issue. When we've been polling, we're pretty consistently asking people in every poll right now, how do you plan to vote? And it looks like about 15% of people want to vote by mail. But there's a huge increase in the number of people who want to vote in early voting. So we need to make sure that they are ready to vote during early voting. When you disaggregate the polls and you look at African-American voters, very few African-American voters, like probably fewer than 10%, want to vote by mail. They don't trust it. They're worried that their vote won't count. They understand what happens with voter suppression. They want to show up at the polls. They want to be able to vote safely, and they want to be able to fill out their ballot and put it in the machine and have that ballot counted. And so to the extent that that the Democratic Party or that an organization like Neighbors on Call pushes for mail-in voting over other forms of in-person voting, we are actually signaling to African-American voters that we don't understand your concerns about voter suppression, and that we want you to vote the way we want you to vote rather than the way that you trust it. And I don't think we can afford to turn off African-American voters by trying to force them to do a voting method that they don't believe will result in their vote being counted. So I really think we have to have an approach that says to people, here are your choices for voting. How do you want to vote? And we can help you figure out how to vote that way that you decide is the best way for you to make sure that your ballot is counted.
Can I tack on to that, Patience? Sure. I agree with everything that Graig just said, and I have worked with Dr. Spearman, the president of the state NAACP, on this issue in Guilford County, and he's exactly right. I mean, African American voters have been so disenfranchised in so many ways with voter ID laws, with gerrymandering, with the closing down of early voting locations in their neighborhoods. They just do not trust vote by mail, so many of them. So they do want to show up at the polls. And what we've done here is to expand those early voting times and try to expand those early voting locations to make it as safe as possible so that people can show up early and not wait in long lines where they might be exposed to the pandemic and they can vote in person still.
Okay.
Ann just pointed out, Ann Wisnes just pointed out that you've seen voting scripts that do encourage people to vote by mail. And at least from the scripts that we're sending out from the House Caucus and our campaigns are using, all of those scripts are gonna shift over the next week or two because of the data that I just shared with you.
Okay. Nicole, you were once an executive in the once flourishing textile and furniture industry. Can you speak about funding for retraining workers and attracting new industries in your district?
Sure, that is something I'm passionate about as well. I worked with Guilford Mills. When I came to work here with them, there were, I believe, 6 plants in Greensboro. Over time, we saw a lot of that business going to Southeast Asia, and rounds of layoffs began until they eventually closed their doors. So we lost a lot of good paying jobs with good benefits here. And there wasn't any retraining to help these workers transition to new jobs that pay well. So, you know, we do have good jobs here. Honda Jet came to Greensboro, but they require a little extra training. So I am a big proponent of work development programs. I think mentorships, apprenticeships, all of those are great programs to help workers who are transitioning from maybe one industry to another to get them ready for emerging industries. I also think they're a great alternative for students who are graduating and maybe they don't see them on a university path. So that helps them develop the skills they need to get a good paying job so that they can make a living.
This question, both of you can answer. What can be done to counter the resegregation of the schools, our schools via charters and so forth? And there was a related question, I think. Do you think that the pandemic, unfortunately, will promote school choice more and result in more funding leaving public schools?
Graig, you want to tackle that first? Do you want me to?
That's right, Nicole. You're the candidate. You can, I'll be happy to fill in, but you can start.
So I believe that our public schools are ours. So I think, you know, we've got to fully fund those schools so that they make them work for everyone. I do not believe that the money should go with the student to the charter school and then if it never comes back to the school system that it was in originally. My belief is if people are going to send their kids to charter schools, then there should be access for everyone. Most of those schools don't provide transportation. They don't all provide free lunches. So that makes them inaccessible to a large percentage of our population and leads to that resegregation that you're talking about. So we need to hold them to standards that allow anyone to attend if they are going to continue to exist.
And I would say that one thing that we could put into policy would be that we could either require charter schools to reflect various aspects of diversity that their local school district reflects, or we could incentivize charter schools to do that by making it easier for them to get a charter, retain their charter if they do, and that would help with addressing the resegregation issue.
Okay. Nicole, is District 59 starting school in person, or will schools open via distance learning? And if distance learning, how is the legislature supporting students who need computers and money to afford broadband access?
So we are going to have our first 9 weeks through October 10th in as virtual learning. And at that point, as we approach the end of that, our school system will reconsider if we can go back to in-person learning. We are providing everyone here with tablets. As far as the Wi-Fi availability, that becomes an issue because not everyone does have access. You have rural areas that don't have the capacity for streaming, and you have lower income students who just don't have high speed internet at home. And they are, this past semester, you know, going to parking lots of businesses or libraries or whatever to try to learn. So I am actually not sure how we address that issue of the Wi-Fi availability, but I do support what Sharon Contreras, our superintendent, has proposed here. Her first consideration is public health and keeping these students safe. And we are continuing the grab and go lunch program that started when we had to begin virtual learning in the spring, so that hopefully the kids who need it are still getting meals. But Graig, do you have any answers on what we are doing at the state level about Wi-Fi access?
So the state has a grant program called the Great Grant Program that is our attempt to improve rural broadband access. But it has some significant limitations, the first of which being it's not enough money. It was only $15 million last year, and it probably is going to cost us about $500 million to make sure everybody has broadband access in North Carolina. So $15 million versus $500 million, like we're not even getting close, right? And it's also limited to the poorest of our counties. So Orange County is not eligible for it, even in the areas where we don't have rural broadband. And the same thing would be true in Guilford County. Neither Orange nor Guilford are eligible for that funding. So we really need a good statewide solution to recognize that broadband is a 21st century necessity. And it's just another one of the issues that Republicans have failed to lead on, even though they talk about all that they do on it. They really haven't improved broadband access at all.
Okay. Bonnie, we're coming to the end of our time here. Is there any question that I overlooked that we should go back to before we finish up here?
No, I think you hit all the ones. Okay. Patience. Nice job, everybody.
Okay, back to you, Becca and Susan.
Okay, thank you guys. Oopsie, I'm going to let you see me again. Thank you so much. This has just been great tonight. I think we could really enjoy going on and on, but in the interest of time, let me just remind folks to sign up for the phone banks. We've got quite a few up ahead, and to join us on August 10th. We've clearly got so much interest in how to vote, and that whole session will be devoted to all of the things you need to know about casting your ballot. So that's August 10th, and it's a Monday. We've usually been doing Wednesdays. Now, I understand, Representative Meyer, that you have said you would be willing to do us a song.
I'd be happy to. I need you to give me co-host ability so I can share my screen, and then I'd be happy to play you out.
All right, hang on. Just give me a second here.
So Knack asked, when I do my Facebook Lives, we always play out with a song, so they asked if I would be willing to play out with a song, so of course I would. Thanks for having us on, y'all. Thanks for featuring Nicole. Please, please send your volunteer hours and your donations to Nicole. We're going to need every bit of support we can to win that race. It's going to be so close. And she's running against someone who is going to be a very well-funded opponent. So we're optimistic about her race. It's going to be one of the top ones in the state. But we certainly not one that we can take for granted. So thanks for doing all you can to support her. And let's see. All right, here we go.
Can you hear that?
The Temptations, y'all. Ain't too proud to beg. We need your votes. We need your hours. We need your donations. We're not too proud to beg for any of it. We need you to do more than Zoom. We need you to get on the telephone. It's easy to watch these. We need you to talk to voters. I'm too proud to beg for it. Nicole, you want to beg for anything?
All of the help that you've been giving my race. Great pick.
I know it. You knew which age group we were, didn't you? My college.
Well done.
You see Bonnie and I are up here. Well, okay.
Thank you so much for making it, buddy. Bye, bye. Night, everybody. Night. Bye, okay. I love the dancing. I love it. I love seeing people dancing.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Bye-bye, everybody. Love you all.
So much.
Bye.
Thank you.
Hey, Dan, but it's been so much.